Epic Church, it's so good to be with you today. I want to add my welcome to all of you who are in the house, also to those of you who are joining us online right now, live, or maybe later this week. Thank you for joining us as well. If we haven't had a chance to meet, my name is Ray, and I serve as the executive pastor here at Epic. And today we're in part two of a teaching series called At the Movies, where we use movies to help us understand and apply the principles of living that are found in God's Word, the Bible. And so we do this series every year. It's a lot of fun. And this year we decided that we would use movies from 2013. Why 2013? Great question. The reason is because that's when we started Epic Church, so we thought it'd be kind of fun to go back in time and grab the top grossing films of that year to look at. And we're not like necessarily saying you should watch these films. These are just the top four grossing films of that year. And today's movie is actually The Hunger Games Part 2, Catching Fire. Now, if you don't know anything about this movie, I want to make it clear that it is not a movie about competitive eating involving spicy food. It's not what it's about at all. Netflix probably has a show like that. You could probably find that somewhere to watch. But no, Hunger Games is actually a series of four movies that tell the story of Katniss Everdeen, who along with Peeta Mellark is a victor of the 74th annual Hunger Games. And as victors, that means that they won money and supplies and food for themselves and for their home districts. It also means that they won the right to never compete in those games again. But it would be wrong to call them winners, because as their mentor, Haymitch Abernathy, tells them, nobody ever wins the games, period. There are survivors, there's no winners. And that's because they live in a post-apocalyptic country called Pan-Em that's run by this government called the Capital, an oppressive and totalitarian government. And while the ruling class is wealthy and lives in luxury and entitled, the average citizens of all the other districts have little freedom, less food, and no hope. And if that wasn't bad enough, the Capitol created the Hunger Games as a punishment for a past rebellion. And so every year, the 12 districts must send two tributes to the games, one male, one female, between the ages of 12 and 18. And these 24 children must fight to the death on live TV, nonetheless, until there's only one survivor remaining. Now, in many ways, the plight of Katniss and Peeta really imitates the people of Pan-Em. See, the slogan of the Hunger Games is, may the odds be ever in your favor. But the reality is for Peeta and Katniss and the people of Pan-Em, the odds are never in their favor. They have no opportunity to thrive. All they know is hardship and struggle. They're barely hanging on. They're barely just surviving. And I think that for some of us watching online, some of us in the room, we're feeling the same way. Because the events of the last year, they were hard. It's been a challenge as we experienced the pandemic and racial injustice and economic uncertainty and so many other things. I know not for all of us. You know, some of us, it was an okay year, but for many of us, it was hard. It was a challenge, and it only amplified the things we were already facing, because some of you here in the room today, some of you watching online, you've got a friend who has cancer, or maybe you have a close loved one who's struggling with depression or anxiety or trauma. For others of you, it's a financial struggle. Maybe you're facing lots of debt or unemployment. For many of us, it's a relationship that's in trouble. And for some of us, it's just that we feel all alone. And I think that most of us, we're ready for a change. Like, we're tired of barely hanging on. We want to go from surviving to thriving. And in a few moments, we're going to talk about, I'm going to share some thoughts about, well, how can we do that? What does that look like? But first, I know that for some of you in the room, some of you watching online, you're just not convinced. You're not quite sure that it actually can change or that it even will change, because you're beaten down by the struggles and you're discouraged by the brokenness of the world around you, and all you see is division and struggle, and you feel like the people of Pan-Em, that the odds are never in your favor. Well, Epic Church, I'm here to tell you today that there is good reason for hope, because Jesus came to flip the script, and he forever put the odds in our favor, because he is the almighty Son of God, the one who was and is to come, and he set us free through his death and resurrection, and one day he is coming back to set all things right on this earth. And in the meantime, while we wait for him, like, we don't have to just get by. We don't have to survive. No, in fact, Jesus actually wants us to thrive. Look at what he says in John chapter 10, verse 10. He says, I have come so that they may have life and may have it. What's that word? Come on, everybody in the room, say it with me with your best, like, outside voice. You ready? Here we go. Abundantly. Yeah. Abundantly. If you're watching online, type that in the chat, even if you're unsure how to spell it. Just put it in there. Because this word is huge for us today. It's so important. It means more than one would normally expect or anticipate. In other words, it means that Jesus came to give us more life than we could ever imagine. More life than we could ever imagine. And this isn't just about the hope of eternal life in heaven with him. No, no, this is for right here, right now. It means that we both have the hope of heaven and the best quality of life here on this earth. Not because we get everything we want. Not because everything goes easy and is never difficult. No, because Jesus is our source of strength and of comfort and of confidence and contentment. But just like in the Hunger Games, y'all, there's some obstacles that have to be overcome in this life. And that's why Jesus also said in John 16:33, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In the world you have trouble and suffering. It happens. There's no way around it. But he says, take courage. I have conquered the world. I love this verse because Jesus gives us both a promise and a perspective. The promise is that in him we have peace, but sometimes we misunderstand that promise. We think that having peace in Jesus means nothing bad will ever happen to us. But Jesus knew that the struggle is real. And so he gives us a perspective, a mindset for dealing with the struggles in life. He says, take courage. I have conquered. You know what this means, everybody, right? This means that Jesus is undefeated. Jesus is undefeated. So in the struggle, we are confident because our trust is in the undefeated, undisputed champion of the world. I feel like I should say that with some kind of boxer ring announcer voice, like the undefeated. Okay, maybe not. But that's who he is, the undefeated, undisputed champion of the world. But look, I get it. Sometimes it's like, okay, that sounds awesome, but how does that really play out in real life? Because, you know, when it gets tough and when the struggle's real, we start... It gets difficult to trust. Like when the rent is due, but the paycheck is gone. Or like when we go to the doctor and we find out we have to have some testing done right away. Or when we're struggling to forgive that parent or that spouse or that son or that daughter or that friend who's hurt us and they don't even care that they've broken the relationship. I mean, it gets tough in times like that. But remember, Epic Church, Jesus wants us to thrive. That's why he came, so that we can have life. So how can we take courage? How can we move from surviving to thriving as we trust in Jesus? Well, in the time we have left today, we're going to look at something that was written in the New Testament book of Hebrews. It was written to some of the earliest followers of Jesus within just a few decades of Christ's death and resurrection. And these were people who had converted from Judaism to following after Jesus, and now they were being persecuted for their faith in him. They were struggling and facing hardships, and they were being tempted to abandon their faith. But the writer of Hebrews, he calls them to persevere. Look at what he says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, in other words, because many, many people have been faithful before us and are now cheering us on, that's the imagery here, he says, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up. And let us run with, this is another important word, let's say it together, everybody with me right now, endurance. Let us run with endurance the race that God has set before us. This word endurance is important because this is how God defines thriving. Look at this definition of how it was used in the New Testament. It means the characteristic of a people who are not swerved from their deliberate purpose nor their loyalty to faith and holy Christ-like living, even when facing the greatest trials and sufferings. A people unswerved. A people deliberate, holding fast to their purpose, to their faith, to the way that God has called them to live, no matter what they might be facing. That's amazing. And that's what I want most of all in my life, is to stay faithful. That someday I would stand before God and he would say, you did it. You were a faithful all-in follower of Jesus, and that is my prayer and my hope for every single one of you in this room, every single one of you watching online, that you would get to the end of your life, you would stand before God, and he would say, Levi, you did it. Mike, you did it. Sarah, you were an all-in follower of Jesus. You made it. You honored me, and I am so proud of you. All right, so how do we do this? How do we learn to run with endurance? How can we learn to thrive no matter what we might be facing? Like I said, I want to share three thoughts with you. And here's the first one. Number one is endurance only comes through training. Endurance or thriving only comes through training. In the movie, there's a scene where Katniss and the other tributes are training. They're preparing for the upcoming Hunger Games. And in this scene, man, Katniss, well, she shows everybody what she's capable of. Why don't you go ahead and take a look at this?
Good news. At least half the tributes want you as an ally.
Well, they saw her shoot.
Well, sweetheart, you got your pick of the litter.
I want Wyrus and Beatty.
Joanna calls them nuts and bolts.
Well, okay, good. Now, who else?
Mags. All right, fine, then no one.
I'll tell them you're still making up your mind.
No wonder everybody wanted to be her ally. When you can shoot like that, you're going to have a lot of friends in the Hunger Games. But, you know, as good as she was shooting a bow, that didn't happen for her overnight. I mean, Katniss was trained by her father. She spent years practicing and hunting in the woods. Even real-life professional archers today, they practice like 6 hours a day, 6 days a week. I mean, why so much time? Well, because I don't know this for sure. I've never done it, but I've read about it this week. It's because the most difficult thing about shooting a bow is consistently using the same technique over and over and over again. And the only way you get that is through hours of training. The same is true of running a race. As a runner myself, I know that runners only have the stamina to finish the race because they have run many, many times before. And the writer of Hebrews, he understood this, and he knew that God had a training regimen for us in our faith. Look at what he says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 7. He says, endure hardship as discipline. Wait, what now? I don't think I've read, what does that say? Hardship, struggle, trials? That's God's training program? Yes. Seriously? As serious as I'm standing here right now. You see, following Jesus, it doesn't mean we avoid the hardship. But what it does mean is that the hardship is not wasted. Where we see an interruption, God sees an invitation to trust him, to grow, and to thrive. I mean, think about it. When do you seek God the most? When life is easy or when it's hard? And look, don't hear what I'm not saying. I'm not saying that God makes bad things happen in our life and that he enjoys watching us suffer. Of course not. I'm not saying that. And the writer of Hebrews, he knew that some of his readers would be wondering the same thing. So he continues in verse 7, God is treating you as his children, for what children are not disciplined by their father? I mean, every parent in this room, every parent through the annals of time has been accused by their children of not loving them because they disciplined them, right, parents? You know what I'm talking about. It's not fair. Why do I get in trouble for this? Well, look, parents, we understand, don't we, that one of the best ways that we can love our kids is through discipline, which means like the training and the instruction and the guidance and the correction. And yes, sometimes punishment or consequences when it's warranted, but mostly it's about training. And why do we love our kids like that? Why don't we just let them do whatever they want? Because we know that training will allow them to thrive. So the question is, will we see hardship as an obstacle or as an opportunity? As an obstacle or an opportunity? Because maybe you're facing an issue at work. What if that's an opportunity for you to grow in your leadership? Or maybe you're struggling at school, and maybe it's an opportunity for you to know and have confidence in what God says about you and who you are, not what other people, your peers, think about you. Or maybe you have a teenager who's testing boundaries, and it's an opportunity for you to bring that child before the Lord in prayer and to trust in your own heart that God is working in their heart, even if you can't see it quite yet. Or maybe you're struggling with a chronic illness, and maybe that's an opportunity to trust in the Lord your God and let him be your strength even in your weakness. I don't know what it might be for you, but I will say this. I'll admit it's not always easy for me to see hardship as an opportunity to grow. And that's why my personal quiet time with God is so important every morning. Reading scripture, reflecting on it, praying to God, asking what he's trying to tell me. It reminds me every day to put my trust in him. And if you don't have a quiet time, I encourage you this week, get one started. Don't delay. Go home after service and spend some time with God. And I want to encourage you, if you don't know how to do that, go to our website, epicchurchbuffalo.com/soap, the word soap, S-O-A-P. It actually stands for Scripture, Observation, Application, Prayer. On that page, it explains what that is. It's a method of digging into God's word, helping you get the most out of your quiet time. There are Bible reading plans there for you as well. But I encourage you with everything I've got, take a look at that, because submitting to God's training is worth it. Look at what he says in Hebrews 12:11. It says, no discipline is enjoyable while it's happening. It's painful. But afterward, there will be a peaceful harvest of right living for those who are trained in this way. So how do we go from surviving to thriving? Well, the first thing is that we understand that endurance comes from training. The second thing is this, that we never run alone. Never run alone. A few years ago, my daughter Ava decided that she wanted to run a 5K, which is 3.1 miles, and she was going to do that with the Girls on the Run program, which is a program for girls in grades 3 through 5. And because I'm her dad and I'm a runner, she asked me to be her running buddy. And I was like, yeah, sure, this will be great. And there's a couple pictures coming up of us at some of the races we've run together. It was cold that day. I had on lots of layers, as you can tell. Now, it's actually a requirement of Girls on the Run that every girl who participates in the program must have a running buddy. You are not allowed to run the race on your own. Why? Because they know that somewhere in that 3.1 miles, you're going to want to give up and to stop running. But they also know that if you have somebody running with you, you will finish the race. The writer of Hebrews, guess what? He understood this as well. Look at what he wrote in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 23 through 24. It says, let us hold tightly without wavering to the hope we affirm, for God can be trusted to keep his promise. Let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. Epic Church, did you catch that? It's saying that the purpose of church is not about what I can get out of it, but about what I can give. See, it's about how I can motivate you and how you can motivate me to live the life that God is calling us to live. And so we need each other because we're better together than we are alone. Now, in the movie, Katniss and Peeta, you saw in that earlier clip that they were discussing whether or not they were going to team up with some people. And eventually they decide to do that. And there's a picture there of some of their allies. But even up until the night before the game started, Katniss was ready to go alone. She was like, no, just you and me, Peeta, we're going to take on everybody else. It was only after the game started that they teamed up. And you know what? I think many of us are the same way. Like, we just have this tendency to isolate when things get tough, when situations get hard. Like, we just want to keep people at an arm's length. And look, I get it. I mean, it was way easier this last year to kind of just shrink back and keep everybody else out here. And I know it takes energy to engage with people. And some of us, like, we just don't know if we have the energy right now to engage with other people. Maybe we're even wondering, I don't think I ever have the energy to do that. Some of us were worried, you know, like, well, if I open up to other people, let them know what I'm going through, are they going to judge me? Are they going to think less of me? Will they accept me? I get all of that. But here's what I know. Alone, we are weak. But together, we are strong. That's why Hebrews 10:25 says, let us not neglect our meeting together, as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near. Epic Church, what about you? And I want you to be honest with yourself right now. Are you running alone? Are you struggling in your faith, tripping over sin on a regular basis, feeling as though God is like abandoned you? Let me encourage you, stop running alone. Look, I get it. This last year was hard. We've been through a difficult season, but come on, don't do life alone. And there are a lot of ways to re-engage. There's a lot of ways to get connected with other people. And it might take some energy, but we can do it. And here's a few ways that you can do that here at Epic Church. For example, our groups, our summer semester, it started a couple of weeks ago, but there's still time for you to get into a group. If you want to find out which group might work for you, like go to our website, use our church app, click that groups button, or go out here to the lobby and stop by the Next Steps area. Get signed up for a group today. Don't do life alone. Or you could serve on the dream team. The dream team is what we call everybody who serves on a team here at Epic Church. And I'm telling you, every team is always looking to add new players. And if you're not on the dream team, there's no better time than right now to get plugged in. I want to encourage you to sign up for and to be at that next Discover Epic, because we will help you figure out your best fit on the dream team. Or maybe you've just gotten out of the habit of attending services in person or gathering together online. I want to encourage you, now is the time to reestablish that habit. Now is the time to set aside time every week to be here in person or to gather your household online. Why? Because there is just something incredibly powerful and encouraging about experiencing the presence of God together. So we're talking about, you know, how can we go from surviving to thriving and learning to run with endurance? And here's the last thought I have for you today, and it's simply this. Remember why you run. Remember why you run. And here's what I mean by that. What is our motivation to finish the race that God has set before us? Yes, we learn endurance through training, and yes, we never run alone so that we have encouragement from others as we seek to finish the race, but why did we start running in the first place? In the beginning of the movie, Katniss and Peeta are on tour as victors, and their first stop is District 11. And in their speech, they eulogize the fallen tributes of that district. And Katniss says something that alludes to why she fought in the games in the first place. Take a look at this.
Ladies and gentlemen, the victors of the 74th Hunger Games, Katniss Everdeen and Peeta Lalonde.
Smile, 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 smile. Stand up straight. You're on camera.
Thank you. We are honored to be here with you today and to be with the families of your fallen tributes.
He put down the cards.
Though they fought,
why do
I bother? With honor and dignity until the end, both Thresh and Rue. We're so young. But our lives aren't just measured in years. They're measured in the lives of people we touch around us. For myself, for Katniss, we know that without Rue and without Thresh, we wouldn't be standing here today. So in recognition of that, knowing that it in no way can make up for your loss, we'd like to donate 1 month of our winnings to the families of the tributes every year for the rest of our lives.
Can you do that?
He can't, but he did.
Why doesn't he just stick to the cards?
Thank you.
I just wanted to say that I didn't know Thresh. I only spoke to him once. He could have killed me, but instead he showed me mercy. That's a debt I'll never be able to repay. I did know Rue. She wasn't just my ally, she was my friend. I see her in the flowers that grow in the meadow by my house. I hear her in a Mockingjay song. I see her in my sister Prim. She was too young, too gentle. And I couldn't save her. I'm sorry.
You see, in the first movie, we learned that it was actually Prim who was selected as the tribute for the games. And immediately Katniss volunteers, take me instead. Why? Because she was so desperate to save her sister that she was willing to go to the games even if it meant dying herself. And I know it's not exactly the same, but I can't help but think about what Jesus did for us. I want you to think about it with me. I mean, our sin, those choices that we make to put our ways over God's ways. Those sins, they not only separate us from God, but they also condemn us to death. And because God loves us so much, because he was so desperate to save us, Jesus did something that was kind of reckless. He said, I volunteer. I will die in their place. And so he came to this earth. He died for you, he died for me, but the good news is he didn't stay dead. No, he rose again on the third day, defeating death, defeating sin once and for all. The tyranny and penalty of it is gone, and he gives us life, abundant life, life beyond what we can expect or anticipate, more life than we can even imagine. And you see, Epic Church, that is why we run. Because Jesus first ran for us. The writer of Hebrews says it like this in Hebrews 12, verses 2 and 3. We do this, that is, run with endurance, by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. Think of all the hostility he endured from sinful people, and then you won't become weary and give up. So, Epic Church, when the struggles happen, and they will, we look to Jesus. And when we get discouraged, and we will, we look to Jesus. And when we feel like giving up, we look to Jesus, because no matter what we might be facing, it is possible to endure. It is possible to thrive if we keep our eyes on him. Would you pray with me together today? Father, we come before you and we thank you that we can gather in this place. We can gather online in your presence and experience your love and your mercy today. And God, we thank you that you loved us so much, that you wanted to save us, and that Jesus, you stepped up and you volunteered to take our place. And we give you praise and thanks for that today. And as we're here in this moment in your presence, I want to pray, Father, first of all, for those who might be struggling right now as they try to go through this journey. They're trying to endure the hardships. They're struggling in their faith. Maybe they're getting tripped up by sin, their own choices. They're wondering if you're really for them. God, I pray that today they would be able to understand that, yes, the promise is that we have peace in Jesus, but the perspective is that we learn endurance through the struggles, through the training, and that they would be able to come with a fresh energy to see the opportunity, not the obstacle, but the opportunity to grow and to trust in you more and more each and every day. For those, Father, who are here and they realize that they've been running alone. Maybe they didn't mean to, or maybe they were trying to do it all on their own all along, but they realized that by themselves they're weak, that we're better together, because when together we're strong, two are better than one, your word tells us. So God, I pray that you would give them the energy to re-engage, to initiate and foster relationships, that you would remove the fear that might be there about what's someone going to think. Am I going to be accepted? Are they going to judge me? And that they would get involved, whether it's through a group or serving on the dream team or just being here or online. God, that we would not do life alone. And for those of us who may be in the room watching online, who realize that you've actually never started running the race to begin with, that you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, today is your day to start running with him. Today is your day to give your life to him. And if that's you, and you want to experience that new life, that life beyond what you can really expect or anticipate, then say something like this in the quietness of this moment in your own heart. Father in heaven, I know that my sin, my choices have led me away from you, and that I deserve death. I deserve punishment, but you don't treat us like we deserve. And you sent your son, Jesus, you volunteered for me. And you came and died in my place, but you rose again on the third day. Set me free once and for all. And I want that freedom, and I want that life that you came to give to me. And so here I am in this moment, giving myself over to you, surrendering to you as the Savior and Lord of my life. May your Spirit fill me up so that with your help, I can live all of my life as an all-in follower of Jesus. We thank you, God, again, that we can be in your presence. We thank you for the truth of your word. And we thank you that we can be made new and changed through your Spirit. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. And everyone who agreed said, amen.